At the end of Act 1, Scene 2, we hear from the Duchess of Gloucester. This is the only scene she's in. And she's speaking with Gaunt, and the topic of the discussion with Gaunt is the accusation that Richard II was involved in the murder of her husband. And at the end of this scene, we have this sad and moving statement that she makes. She says, "Alack, and what shall old good York find at Plashy but empty lodgings and unfurnished walls, unpeopled offices, untrodden stones? And what hear there for welcome but my groans? Therefore commend me, let him not come there to seek out sorrow that dwells everywhere. Desolate, desolate will I hence and die, the last leave of thee takes my weeping eye." The Duchess expresses her own personal sorrow, but it seems that she's also saying something about the state of England as it exists under the rule of this unstable leader. In the previous discussion, we saw that in Act 1, Scene 1, the situation between Bolingbroke and Mowbray is described using these words like boisterous, malice, treachery, frowning. We have an accuser, we have an accused, we have men who are high-stomached, that is, angry, we have ire, we have rage. But it seems like these words also describe England to some degree. And then we have this weird situation where, after hearing about all of that, then Bolingbroke shows up. And he uses happy language. "Many years of happy days befall my gracious sovereign, my most loving liege." And then we have Richard II referring to himself sometimes in the first person plural, us, our, sometimes in the first person singular, me. And this will often be in the same sentence, in the same statement. As the scene continues, these themes continue. Mowbray follows Bolingbroke, referring to happiness, referring to the earth's good hap, that is, the earth's good fortune, being under the rule of Richard II. And then Richard II, in the same statement, using the first person plural, the first person singular, interchangeably, our, my, our, my, our, I. And that by itself may not mean very much, but as we gain more insight into this unstable leader, then perhaps his use of these pronouns, the way he changes these pronouns, perhaps it does have some significance. And so, very early in the play, we seem to have things that are disjointed. We have words that convey tension and conflict, but then these words of happiness, and we have this person referring to himself in different ways in the very same sentence. The tension grows as the scene continues. Bolingbroke and Mowbray, now standing before Richard II, are hurling accusations of treason against one another. Bolingbroke says to Mowbray, "Thou art a traitor and a miscreant. You are too good to be so and too bad to live," seeming to say, "Mowbray, given your status, given your rank in society, being a traitor should be beneath you. You are too good to be a traitor, and yet because you are a traitor, you should not live." Bolingbroke calls Mowbray a foul traitor. Mowbray responds, "I do defy Bolingbroke. I spit at him. I call him a slanderous coward and a villain. Most falsely doth he lie." And as these two go back and forth, they hurl other accusations. And they also to agree to meet in mortal combat, to fight to the death. And all of this is taking place in front of Richard II. Now at the same time, Bolingbroke and Mowbray express their love for Richard II. They speak to him using words of reverence. Bolingbroke says to Richard II, "Come I appellant to this princely presence." Mowbray says that each day still better others' happiness. The days just get better and better and better so long as Richard II is on the throne, until the heavens, envying earth's good hap, add an immortal title to your crown. The heavens are envious of England because it has a leader such as Richard II. And later, Mowbray says that he will throw himself at the feet of Richard II. Now, as all of this is going on, Richard is curiously uninterested in the argument itself. Richard makes no attempt to find out who is right. Is Bolingbroke right? Is Mowbray right? He makes no attempt to find out whether one of them is more right than the other. He asks no questions. He launches no investigation. He shows no curiosity. He does say that they should not move on to mortal combat, that they should retract their challenges to one another to fight to the death. But he shows no interest in the argument itself. And Richard II has been spoken to as if he's a great power. The heavens are envious because of Richard's greatness, the greatness of his rule. That's what Mowbray says. Richard II speaks as a king. He says, "Wrath kindled gentlemen, be ruled by me. I am, after all, the king. I'm here to rule. Be ruled by me." But what's interesting is that Bolingbroke and Mowbray, despite what they have said, will not be ruled by Richard II. He will tell them not to head down the path of mortal combat. He will tell them to basically give up the argument. He has no interest in finding out who's right, who's wrong, who's more right, who's more wrong. He just says, you know, let's just not have this argument. But they do not heed what he says. They do not obey what he says. Richard II says, "We were not born to sue, but to command." Here he is now again speaking of himself in the first person plural. "We were not born to sue." In other words, it's not my place as king to ask you to do something. It's my place as king to command you to do something. But then look at the very next line, "which since we cannot do to make you friends." So Richard II himself acknowledges that his two subjects, Bolingbroke and Mowbray, despite what they've said to him about his greatness, they will not obey him when he says that they should not head down the path of mortal combat. And in fact, he concedes to them. He says, "Be ready as your lives shall answer for it at Coventry upon St. Lambert's Day." And so we see Richard II claiming his power, "I was born to command," but the very next line acknowledges that his command is not having any effect on these two subjects of his. Scene 2 takes us to that discussion between John of Gaunt and the Duchess of Gloucester. And Gaunt says to the Duchess, "Alas, the part I had in Woodstock's blood doth solicit me," he's Woodstock's brother, "to stir against the butchers of his life. But since correction lies in those hands which made the fault that we cannot correct, put we our quarrel to the will of heaven." The implication here is that Richard II, the king himself, was involved in the murder of the husband of the Duchess of Gloucester. But what can Gaunt do? If the king did that, what can Gaunt do? And so Gaunt has to put the quarrel to the will of heaven, who, when they see the hours ripe on earth, will rain hot vengeance on offenders' heads. And so Gaunt looks to the heavens to make right what has happened on the earth. Later, in this discussion between Gaunt and the Duchess of Gloucester, Gaunt says, "God's is the quarrel. For God's substitute, his deputy anointed in his sight, hath caused his death." Well, here's a direct statement. Gaunt is saying Richard II had a hand in the death of the Duchess's husband. But Richard II is God's substitute. Here's this medieval idea that the king is God's representative on earth. And we see this later in the play. Richard II will make this claim of himself. "And so let heaven revenge, for I may never lift an angry arm against his minister, that is, against his king. So Gaunt says, I can't act against Richard. Richard is God's representative. The heavens will have to do what the heavens will have to do. Notice the situation here. Mowbray says that the heavens are envious because such a great king rules in England. Gaunt says, let the heavens wreak vengeance on this king for what he has done. There's yet another disconnect. So we haven't gotten very far into the play, but there are a number of disconnects that we can observe here. And then as we read Gaunt's words, I don't think that we're reading words of faith, that Gaunt really has faith that heaven will sort all of this out. These words sound more like resignation. What can you do? What can you do if we have a ruler like Richard II on the throne? And so we have individuals, the Duchess of Gloucester, who expresses her sorrow. But she says there's a sorrow that dwells everywhere. And what causes that? What's at the root of that? Unstable leadership, certainly. A lack of confidence in the system. What a king can do and get away with. What happens when we can't trust the person at the very top of the political system? Resignation in the face of injustice. These sorts of things have a terrible effect on a society.